السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
الخطبة بتاعتك كانت A100 بلس. ما شاء الله لا قوة إلا بالله.
اللهم تقبل رب العالمين. اللهم تقبل.
إن شاء الله he will. إن شاء الله. It was really really beautiful.
اللهم تقبل رب.
بس أنا قلت ما شاء الله لا قوة إلا بالله.
كان الست دي بتحسب.
يا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. عندكم اكسترا روم يا شيخ رمضان من النبي؟
لا 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 ازاي
مش اكسترا روم
عندنا
عندكم مش انا اللي حاجه عندكم هو اللي هيروح لكم
وعندهم روم زياده
اوكي اي جس اي هاف تو
بس ده شيخ رمضان اي واز
نعم
في الجمعه ما شاء الله ات واز فيري فيري افكتيف ات ليست افكتيف مي
الحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم تقبل يا رب العالمين اللهم تقبل
يا رب العالمين
من الأمانة
زيدك من فضله
الله يبارك فيك الله يبارك
من فضله
شو بتعلم
ما بيعرفش عربي يا شيخ هنعلمه كمان العربي
من فضله
جزاك الله خير
الله يبارك الله فيك أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد Inshallah ta'ala, today, actually tonight, we will continue with Surah At-Takwir, Surah number 81. And we're starting tonight, inshallah, from ayah number 15. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Fala unqusimu bil khunnas al jawaril kunnas. والليل إذا عسعس والصبح إذا تنفس إنه لقول رسول كريم ذي قوة عند ذي العرش مكين مطاع ثم أمين وما صاحبكم بمجنون ولقد رآه بالأفق المبين وما هو على الغيب بضنين وما هو بقول شيطان رجيم فأين تذهبون إن هو إلا ذكر للعالمين لمن شاء منكم أن يستقيم وما تشاءون إلا أن يشاء الله رب العالمين So we're starting from ayah number 15 tonight. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِالْخُنَّسِ This is an oath. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by certain things in these ayat. Al-khunnas is talking about the retreating celestial bodies, such as the sun, the moon, the planets and also the stars and all these planets and stars and these phenomena Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by them and why he calls them al-khunnas because they are retreating yani they like to us appear during the daytime And we don't see them during the nighttime. Stars, we see them nighttime. We don't see them the daytime. Other people, they see them the time that we don't see them, and they don't see them the time that we see them. So it's different from one place to another, from one location to another. But for us, as we see them in front of us, they appear in the daytime and they retreat in the nighttime and stars appear in the nighttime and they retreat on the daytime. That's the meaning of al-khunnas. فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِالْخُنَّسِ And that's why the following ayah, which is number 16, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-Jawari, Al-Kunnas, they run their courses in their orbits to the east, to the west. They move around, and we know that all these planets and the stars and the sun and the moon, we know that all of them, they have certain kind of movement, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them as al-jawari. And he says, al-jawari, al-kunnas. And al-kunnas means those ones that disappear from the view, that we do not see them. And then he says, wal-layli idha asas. Now we see in the following ayah 17, it's talking about the result, what is happening as a result of the rotation and the movement and the running of these phenomena, these planets and these stars. What will be the result? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, by al-layl, and by the darkness of the night when it comes and goes. Al-layl, meaning the night, idha as'asa, it means when it comes and goes, referring to the darkness of the night, that it comes when the sun sets and it goes away when the sun, rises again the following day. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes this in the most beautiful description in the Quran, وَآيَةٌ لَهُمُ اللَّيْلُ نَسْلَخُ مِنْهُ النَّهَارُ فَإِذَا هُمْ مُظْلِمُونَ. And a sign for them is the night, that we skin the day out of it. You know, subhanAllah, when you skin the goat or the sheep and you take the skin out, so what appears after that? The whiteness of the fat and everything, the body. So that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing when the day comes in the morning and how it is coming out of the darkness of the night, as if you are skinning the goat or the sheep and the body is coming out. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا عَسْعَسَ, when it comes and goes, the darkness of the night. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا تَنَفَّسَ, and he swears by the subh, which is the morning time, the dawn, which is the fajr time, when it appears and it becomes bright and shiny, now it becomes the daytime. We have four ayahs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making an oath by certain creation that he had created, and he is making an oath by them. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this oath? Allah Azza wa Jal is swearing by these things in order to establish for us or to give us evidence of something that we need to believe in. If you remember, one of the main themes of this surah is the Holy Quran and the scenes of the Day of Judgment and how the Quran describes that. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he makes the oath by Al-Khunnas and by Al-Jawari Al-Kunnas and by the night and by the day, now he's saying, indeed, this Quran that you have in your hand and you see it and you read it, it is not the making of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is not the writing of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is the word and it is the message of a noble messenger, an honorable messenger. Who is that messenger that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to? It is Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Innahu laqawlu rasulin kareem. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Who is Jibreel and what's his position? We know that certain angels have a certain rank, a certain level and position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such as Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, Mikael alayhi salatu wasalam, Israfil alayhi salatu wasalam, those who carry the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Hamalatul Arsh, and other angels, they have a special position with Allah Azza wa Jal, the angel of death, and so many other angels. They have a special status with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, Allah Azza wa Jal in ayah number 20, he describes Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam that he is the owner of the tremendous power. He has power. He has authority that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him, that he can ascend and descend at any time, that he can go up and down at any time, and he goes up and down without even asking the permission from the gatekeepers of the heavens. He can go whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him to come down to the earth to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to the other prophets, and he can go up whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him to ascend, and he was not in need of any permission. He does not have to knock at the door of the heaven or the gate of the heaven in order to be open for him. He used to come back and forth with no permission at all. But when he took Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with him to Al-Mi'raj, to the seventh heaven, subhanallah, he did not enter any gate without knocking at the door and asking permission. So Jibreel alayhi salam, whenever he descends and ascends, he was not in need of asking permission at all. But at the time when he took Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Al-Mi'raj, ascended all the way to the seventh heaven, he was asking the permission of every gatekeeper from the sky, from the heavens. Why did he do that with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? In order to teach the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam how to ask the permission when you go to someone's house. And this is an Islamic etiquette. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَدْخُلُوا بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتِكُمْ حَتَّى تَسْتَأْنِسُوا وَتُسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. O believers, do not enter houses other than yours without asking the permission of the people in that house and making salam to them before you enter. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam that he has the tremendous power. He is exalted in rank. He is high in position. And this Quran is given as a message to Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. And he is high in the rank and in the position with the owner of the throne, the owner of the great throne. Who is the owner of the throne? Who is the arsh? The quwwatin inda dhil arshi makin. Who is the owner of the throne? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that means that Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam had a special status with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The quwwatin inda dhil arshi makin. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives another description for Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam in the following ayah number 21. He says, Muta'in thamma amin. Muta'in meaning that he is obeyed by the angels. Yani, as I said, he goes up and down, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him to convey any command to the angels. He conveys it, and the angels obey him, listen to him. So he is being obeyed among the angels. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, من كان عدوا لجبريل وميكائيل وإسرافيل فإن الله عدو للكافرين. من كان عدوا لله وملائكته ورسله وجبريل وميكائيل فإن الله عدو للكافرين. قل من كان عدوا لجبريل فإنه نزله على قلبك بإذن الله مصدقا لما بين يديه وهدى وبشرى للمؤمنين. من كان عدوا لله وملائكته ورسله وجبريل وميكائيل فإن الله عدو للكافرين. Here in these two ayahs from Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had stated a fact and refuted an argument and allegation of some people that used to consider Jibreel as their enemy because he is the one that brings the revelation to the prophets and to the messengers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًّا لِجِبْرِيلِ. say whoever is an enemy to Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Now know that Jibreel does not act according to his own discretion or from his own judgment. Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam is following Allah's command exactly as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him to do. فَإِنَّهُ نَزَّلَهُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ. Then tell them that Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam give this Quran, this revelation, and put it in the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, by the will and the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْ, confirming what has been revealed before it of the Torah and the Gospel and the Psalms and the Scriptures, the past revelations that came to the prophets and to the messengers. نَزَّلَهُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. And it is a guide, hudan, it is a good, a bringer of glad tidings and good news to the believers. وَهُدًا وَبُشْرًا لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ, whoever is an enemy to Allah, to his angels, to his messengers, to Jibreel and to Mikael. مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِيكَائِيلَ. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ, then indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is an enemy of the disbelievers. So here, one of the qualities, one of the descriptions of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, that he is being obeyed by the angels in the heavens above us. مُطَاعٍ ثَمَّ, meaning there, يعني in the heavens. أَمِين means trustworthy. And that is the quality, or that is the manner that we were talking about today in the khutbah al-jum'ah. And if you can refer to this khutbah, you see how important this manner of amana, being honest and trustworthy, how vital and important and essential this manner in our life. It is very important to have it. Subhanallah, yani without this manner, there will be, without the manner of the honesty and trustworthiness, there will be no manners, because it is actually the basis of everything in our life. We need it in all our dealings. We need it in all our business. We need it in all aspects of our life. So one of the most beautiful description of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam is that he is Amin. He is trustworthy. You see here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Thamma. Thamma, it's different from Thumma. Thumma, it's a conjunction letter, which actually connects like two actions or two people together. Like you say, for example, Ja'a Muhammadun Thumma Ali, which means Muhammad came, and then later on Ali came after him, after a while. They call it a conjunction that connected the two actions or the two names in action, but there is a period of time between the occurrence of these two actions. And they call it حَفْ عَطْف when they say ثُمَّ. But when you say ثَمَّ, it is an adverb. So we have a difference between ثُمَّ, which is a conjunction, and we have ثَمَّ, which is an adverb referring to the place. ثَمَّ meaning there in the heaven. مُطَاعٍ ثَمَّ أَمِين. And Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam was described as Amin in what? سَمُّهُ أَمِينُ الْوَحِي. Why? Because he did not hide anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him to convey to the prophets and to the messengers, including, but not limited to, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by the stars and the planets and these phenomena to confirm the fact that the Quran is the actual word of Allah that was sent by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is confirming the authenticity, the truthfulness, and the trustworthiness of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Because we have three main things here related to the Quran. We have Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, who carried the message from Allah to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have the Quran itself, the message. And we have Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one to whom the message is conveyed. So in order to make the people believe what is being said to them and what is being revealed to them and conveyed to them of this message, they have to believe in the authenticity of the text itself, which is the Quran, the authenticity and the truthfulness of the one who brought this message to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the authenticity and the truthfulness of the one to whom the message is being conveyed. Because if Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam was not honest and trustworthy, he might have hidden something from that revelation. And if Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not honest and trustworthy, he might have also hidden some of this revelation. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in ayah number 22, وَمَا صَاحِبُكُمْ بِمَجِنُونَ. صَاحِبُكُمْ means your companion. Who is our companion? Who is the companion that Allah is talking about? It is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah said, he is not mad, he is not crazy, he is not insane as you describe him. وَمَا صَاحِبُكُمْ بِمَجْنُونَ. Why? Because he had in fact seen Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. He had seen him in the clear horizon towards the east. When Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam requested Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam to see him in his angelic form. And we know that Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam in the form of a very good looking, handsome companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. His name was Dihya al-Kalbi. That was the man that Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam in his form. But one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam requested Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam to see him in his angelic form. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded Jibreel to meet the request of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And he did that, and he had seen him, his head all the way in the sky, and his legs are going all the way down to the earth, and his wings are spread all over the horizon. And then when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw that, he fell unconscious. And when he retained his consciousness, then Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam describes himself, and he said, you know, my body compared to the body of Mikael, it's like a ring in a desert. Like when you throw a ring, which we wear in our finger, if you throw this ring in the desert, how big is the ring and how big is the desert? So that is comparing the body of Jibreel to one of the other great angels. And then he continued describing for him the other great creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regard to the angels. So anyway, Allah azza wa jal had told the people in this ayah that your companion Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not crazy, he is not insane. He had in fact seen Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam in the clear horizon, and he said to him, ya Muhammad, ana Jibreel, I am Jibreel. So he says, wala qad ra'ahu bil ufuqil mubin wama huwa 'ala al ghaibi bidanin. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam will not withhold any information about the unseen which has been given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to convey to the people. This revelation that we have in our hand, the Quran, it was unseen before. So when it came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he conveyed it to the people, it became seen to the people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your companion Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will never ever withhold, will never ever restrict you guys from the revelation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him. وَمَا هُوَ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ بِضَنِينَ. And this Quran, because they used to say Muhammad has been inspired by his shaitan. Okay. If he is inspired by the shaitan, why will the shaitan curse himself in the message that he has given to Muhammad? We see in the Quran many times that there is a curse for the shaitan. Inna shaitana kana al-insana aduwwan mubeena. Alam a'had ilaykum ya bani adam an la ta'budu ash-shaytan. Inna ash-shaytana lakum aduwwan fattakhidhuhu aduwwa. Yani many times illa iblis kana lam yakun min as-sajidin. قال ما منعك أن تسجد لما خلقت بيدي استكبرتك أم كنت من العالين قال أنا خير منه خلقتني من نار وخلقته من طين قال فاخرج منها فإنك رجيم وإن عليك اللعنة إلى يوم الدين وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله إنه سميع عليم وفي آية أخرى إنه هو السميع العليم. So all these ayat that I'm mentioning now, they include actually a curse of the shaitan. The shaitan is being outcast. So if the shaitan was the one who gives the message to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as some people accused him at the time of that very false accusation, if that is true, why will the shaitan curse himself in the message that he gives to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And it is not the word of a devil outcast. وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ شَيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And we normally, we know how the shaitan whispers to the people to do some kind of poetry, which is not a good poetry. We're not talking about the good one. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ had a poet, Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who used to make and to compile poetry defending Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ used to command him to do that in order to defend the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ شَيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. This Quran is not the message or the saying or the speech of the outcast devil, the shaytan al-rajim. فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. Where are you going? What are you leaving? Why do you leave this message and you turn yourself away from the Quran? Why don't you read it with open eyes? Why don't you just consider it that a piece of literature or a piece of art that came to you, it's a book? Just read it and see what this book is going to tell you. Why do you just judge in the very beginning without even reading it and understanding it and trying to understand its message? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is blaming the people who turn themselves away from the Quran. Where are you going, leaving the Quran, turning yourself away from it? And this is also a message for all of us now. It's actually blaming us for being away from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to keep ourselves connected with the Quran on a daily basis. It doesn't matter how much we're going to read, but at least some verses from the Quran on a daily basis. One verse a day, inshallah, will keep the shaitan away from us. Just even one ayah and understanding the meaning of this ayah, even like few ayahs, a short surah, keep yourself always connected with the Quran. Allah is blaming those people who are turning their face away from the Quran by saying, فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. This Quran, which is in your hand, it is a reminder. It is just a reminder to all the worlds, the mankind, the jinn, to everyone. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا ذِكْرٌ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. The jinn themselves, when they came and they listened to the Quran, they were impressed by the Quran. They were affected by the Quran. They were impacted by it. They went back to their people and they said, سَمِعْنَا كِتَابًا أُنزِلَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مُوسَى مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْحَقِّ وَإِلَى طَرِيقِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. We have heard the book that is revealed after Musa عليه الصلاة والسلام, confirming what was revealed before it. يَهْدِي إِلَى الْحَقِّ, guiding to the truth and to the right path and to the straight way. Ya qawmana, they ask their families, they ask the other jinn to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya qawmana ajibu da'i Allahi wa aminu bih, yaghfir lakum min dhunubikum wa yujirkum min adhab alim. Allah will forgive your sins and will protect you from the punishment. And as we know that when we hear the word jinn, jinn means believers among the descendants of Iblis, and the shayateen means the disbelievers from the descendants of the shayateen. That's why in the Quran we have Surah Al-Jinn, but we don't have Surah Al-Shayateen. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَيَسْتَقِيمُ. For anyone of you who likes to be straightforward, to be upright, to be on the right path. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَيَسْتَقِيمُ. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given us the choice, the option to choose between the truth and the falsehood. And we have the ability to distinguish between them and to understand what is right and what is wrong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَسْتَقِيمُ وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. You will not will anything unless it has been willed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the world. So that means that everything has been decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and our belief in Allah's decree does not negate our will to choose what is right and to set aside what is wrong. We should not hang our mistakes on saying that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees for me to do that or to be in such and such occasion, such and such practice, or such and such manner, such and such bad thing. No, we should not hang our mistakes on the belief in the Qadr, because the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the decree of Allah, is His knowledge, is that He knows what is going to happen, but He does not force us to do anything against our will. This is the last ayah of Surah At-Takwir, وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينفعنا بالقرآن وأن يجعلنا من أهل القرآن وخاصته, إنه على ما يشاء قدير وبالإجابة جدير. إن شاء الله تعالى, tomorrow we will continue with the next surah, Surah Al-Infitar. And until we meet, inshallah, I ask Allah to benefit us from this and to make all of us from those who listen to the words and follow the best of them. So inshallah, if we have any question before we leave for Salat al-Isha, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. It seems that there is no question. So we're going, inshallah ta'ala, to conclude with the dua. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, to bestow His mercy, His forgiveness, His guidance upon us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins and to recover our sick brothers and sisters, and to bestow His mercy and forgiveness upon our dead brothers and sisters. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-huda wa-t-tuqa wal-afafa wal-ghina ومن العمل ما ترضى برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا واستر عيوبنا واشرح صدورنا وبلغنا مما يرضيك آمالنا, وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والعصر, إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. جزاكم الله خيرا, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
يا سيدنا.
يا دكتور.
النهاردة أنا انبسطت جدا من الخطبة بتاعك.
بس ده خارج عن
الموضوع. وكنت يعني قلت يا ريت الناس اللي حوالين المسجد يسمعوا للخطب دي عشان يعرفوا الفرق بين ما تدعو إليه المساجد وما تتحدث عنه
الكنائس.
بعدين فكرت قلت الله, طب احنا ليه ما نعملش اعلان على المسجد عن الخطبة القادمة وموضوعها ايه, وجايز كلها تأثير, جايز الناس تشوفها ويكونوا انترستد في السبجكت ويحضروا او يسمعوا في البيت عندهم او حوالين المسجد. فانا متصور ان هيكون لها تأثير كويس جدا, وخاصة الناس اللي هم حوالين المسجد. ليه ما نكتبش على المسجد الخطبة يوم الجمعة القادمة ستتحدث عن الموضوع الفلاني والفلاني والفلاني. Anybody who's interested will hear that and then try to attend your khutbah and gain from it or learn from it. That idea they got لي لما
يعني فكرة طيبة طبعا.
I was impressed by it. Why not the other people as well?
نعم.
قطع عليك more pressure now. خد بالك الحتة دي قوي.
لا مش
فكرة. فكرة طيبة والله, يعني it's a good idea, إن شاء الله, يعني it's a good idea. We'll see how we do it, يعني like يعني the The sign and the writing and everything. Yes, we see.
Yeah, the people who go around the masjid, their car, they will know ahead of time what your talk on next Friday is going to be on. And if the subject is appealing to them, they will try by any means to come and listen to it.
Naam, naam. Jazakallah khair, doctor. Allah yabarik fik, Allah yajzik khair.
Ameen,
ya Rabbal Alameen. يهدينا جميعا إن شاء الله إلى صراطه المستقيم يا رب العالمين.
آمين يا رب. آمين. جزاك الله خير.
إن شاء الله نراكم غدا إن شاء الله في السادسة والنصف إن شاء الله.
السادسة. إن شاء الله. السلام عليكم.
وعليكم.